Los Angeles African American Chamber of Commerce, better known as GLAAD, and I'm going to serve as your MC this morning. I'd like to take this opportunity and welcome each and every one of you to the 33rd Congressional District's Job and Economy Summit, featuring Representative Karen Bass and Labor Secretary Wilma Sylvia. We're going to spend the morning exploring and discussing strategies, impacts, and solutions to the job market and to our economy in the city of Los Angeles area. We've got a lot of program for you today. We appreciate all of your consideration and patience, and we're going to get this program rolling. First, I'd like to bring her up. Ladies and gentlemen, she founded a nonprofit to address the ills of our community. She went on to become the first African-American woman to lead a state house, and she's now serving in the White House. 33rd Congressional District, U.S. House of Representatives member, Karen Bass.
Washington D.C. and it is definitely a new day and a very serious day for all of us. And I want to thank everyone for taking the time out to come here this morning. I'm very happy that we are fortunate to have the Secretary of Labor here with us. And I just love saying that. On the President's Cabinet. But anyway, you know, I am very appreciative for you for taking the time out to come here and for everyone that came here. As I said, this is definitely a new day that we all need to be very serious and prepared for. You know, in the time that I was in the Assembly, one of the things I took the greatest pleasure with is bringing folks who represent power, who represent serious influence, directly to the community so we could have immediate access to them. And so I'm excited to continue doing that in the role serving in Congress. And one of the things that we've all seen over these last couple of years while we have celebrated the election of President Obama is the difficulty that he has had in trying to move his agenda forward. We know the economy that he inherited. We know the significant job loss, you know, that was occurring. And the fact that he inherited an economy that was getting ready to collapse and having to turn that around, I certainly know how I felt being in Sacramento, being sworn in as Speaker in May and everything collapses a couple of months later. I could only imagine what it felt like to be in charge of the nation, the world's largest economy, and be in that position. And the gains that have been made, whether you're talking about the Recovery Act or healthcare reform or financial reform, and trying to get above the noise with all of the opposition to actually take a minute to take stock in what has been gained and how we build on that and move forward. And one of the things that I think our communities always suffer from is that our news that has now kind of degenerated into big entertainment, it's difficult to actually get the facts and find out actually what did occur. And I know firsthand the Recovery Act certainly saved the state of California, because I know that we were teetering on the edge, and right when that came through, the economic stimulus money allowed California to not have amputations instead of cuts, because that was the direction things were headed. And so one of the reasons why we wanted the Secretary to come today was so you could hear directly from her the impact of what has been going on in the administration, how it has benefited our community, and how we can continue to move forward, but also to do whatever we can to support you in your position and the administration while we work toward 2012 and making sure that our president is reelected. So let me just say that many of you in the room personally know Secretary Solis. We know that she has been a warrior in our community for many, many years before she was in public office, during the years she was in office, whether you're talking about the Assembly, the State Senate, or in Congress. What some of you might not know is that she was the first woman ever to be awarded a JFK, John F. Kennedy Profiles of Courage Award. For her work on the environmental issues. And so all of us were just over the top ecstatic when President Obama tapped her to be the Secretary of Labor, and I'll never forget the press conference that he had when he introduced you and he talked about your background, your family background, and your journey to being where you are now. And so it is with great pleasure, tremendous respect, and excitement that I introduce our Secretary of Labor.
Big difference Last October was the highest rate of unemployment. That was like, we were up at 10%. Now we're at 8.8, and you say, well, it sounds good, but you know, a lot of people are still hurting. And the president knows that. And we know that every single day we have to work towards educating people, making sure that they understand that there are federal dollars still out there, whether it's through construction projects that are still coming, that are going to work their way out of the Beltway and down here, or whether it's going to be opening up opportunities for private sector entrepreneurs to start taking advantage of tax credits. Credits that were passed in December, and I know some people didn't quite understand how all that happened, but I'll tell you that the majority of the tax cuts were not just for that 2% that you keep hearing other people talk about, the very wealthy. This was the first time that we saw an income tax credit and also a sales tax that was given to people, an immediate relief for people to get at least $1,000 right away from payroll tax. And that keeps pushing out. The fact that we were able to extend unemployment insurance for another 7 million people who last year, right before Christmas, remember that? The other side didn't want to budge. They said, hey, you know what? Those people are just sitting there and they're not really looking for jobs. Well, it's hard when you have 5 people for 1 job. And we don't see enough business stimulating to open up opportunities so people can be hired because the demand isn't necessarily all there yet. In part because we lost a lot of jobs. And some of those jobs will never come back. But the good highlight that I will tell you is that 1.8 million private sector jobs were created. And when people talk about where's the middle class and the manufacturing base, one of our strengths has been in the manufacturing base. Those jobs are coming back. Now, the hardest hit for our state and for states like Nevada and Florida have been in housing. And that's going to take a while because there was a lot of things going on there with the financial institutions and the way people were being hurt. And our communities, in many cases, were hurt the hardest. And it's going to take a while to recoup and kind of put back all that credibility with folks that need to purchase homes. We know all of our public sector right now is under fire. I know I have friends here from the community colleges and from our teachers, folks that represent us that stand up every single day and do their job. And right now we hear conversations around the country picking on public sector workers. And I know that for some of you it's hard because we have challenges. We have deficit spending. We have to take care of them. The president has said, let's take care of our house. But let's make sure when we take care of our house that we take care of the most vulnerable. So that means the seniors. That means the young people. That means the vulnerable people that we know in our community.
Good. I just wanted to ask one question, and that was how the Recovery Act dollars, which seem to have trickled through to the black community, especially in construction, that the articles written about it, the percentages are so low. How can more of that money come through to black enterprise so that
I think it's a couple of things. Even before talking about how more of the money can come through, I think that there are current jobs and current construction ventures that African Americans need to participate in more. And one of the things that we have been doing is working a lot with the labor community, various labor unions, to make sure that African Americans get in the apprenticeship programs and can also be a part of the building trade. So specifically, there are a number of apprenticeship programs, and I think we need to get the word out more about those programs. In terms of the recovery money, one of the things that has been frustrating to everybody down the line is that with all of the money that was allocated out of Washington, there's still a large percentage that hasn't made it to the streets. And so I think it's important that our communities stay on top of the recovery dollars and do what we can to advocate for more of those dollars being released. Specific example, when I was in the state legislature, a lot of the dollars were bottlenecked in Sacramento because the economy was so fragile, it was difficult to release the bonds on the street and all of that. And so there are more dollars that are coming our way, and we need to stay on top of it. Now, there was a website, and I believe it still exists, where you can go to ARRA, to the Recovery Act, and you can trace the projects that are supposed to be happening in your community.
Okay.